Hello students, welcome back. Myself Pushpinder Singh, and we are going to start with our NCERT class. Okay, so today you have the history class. So you can supplement your preparation with the help of these lectures. As you know that we are covering NCERT classes through these lectures or NCERT books through these lectures. You can subscribe our channel on the YouTube, and you will get the NCERT based classes on the YouTube on the daily basis. All right, so let's begin with the lecture. Okay, so as we have started our history portion in the last two class, okay, we have seen, you know, various features of the British East India Company, as well as the taken over of, you know, the British East India Company by the Crown. Okay, now through, you know, we have also seen the mutiny or the rebellion which was occurred in 1857. Okay, and after that we have seen how the people fought bravery and how the British basically controlled this rebellion that was completed in 1859. That took almost 2 years for the British or for the Britain to contain this complete rebellion totally. Okay, so now you have seen all such features. Now let's see the cotton mills. Okay, as you have seen that the first cotton mill that was set up in India in 1854, okay, that was set up as a spinning mill in the Bombay. So the first cotton mill, which is also known as the spinning mill, which was set up in Bombay in 1854. From 1854 to 1900, 84 such mills also started operating in the Bombay alone. Okay, now obviously with the setting up of these mills has led to the spurt in the development of cottage factories or cotton factories that is based on such production of such cotton related threads and, you know, basically your clothes. So the cotton factory was basically started producing all such clothes, textiles and etc. Okay, it was during the First World War, as you know that. Okay, the textile imports from the Britain basically declined, right, due to the World War, and the Indian factories basically, you know, benefited out of it, and which has scaled up this production of the production of textiles, right, specifically, you know, made up of cotton, right. So ultimately, you know, for the military supplies, for domestic sale, for international supplies also, the Indian factories, which are basically the cotton textiles, are benefited during the First World War. Okay, now let's understand the Tipu Sultan, right, in the basically Mysore, and also the world famous the wood steel. Okay, so the steel basically used, or this wood steel is basically used for making of, you know, the tools, for example sword, right, which has been very famous, right, very world known. The wood steel for making, you know, the rust-free sword. So the quality of the sword, which came from the special type of the steel, which is to also have the high carbon content, or high carbon steel is also known as wood steel. Okay, this wood steel basically started producing in all over the South India. Okay, it is known for the production of very, you know, high grade, you know, the sword. So the Indian wood steel basically making fascinated the European scientist to look into what is the special quality in this wood steel that makes such a fascinating sword and such a fascinating, you know, the implements. Okay, now the Europeans also interested the wood steel making process, okay, which is widely known in the Southern India. Okay, but it was subsequently lost by the mid 19th century. Obviously, the wood steel basically used in the swords, armor making, and all sort of industries, right? It was declined because of the conquest which was done by the Britain, okay? As well as, you know, the British conquest basically subdued such production in the Southern India. Secondly, right, the iron and the steel, which has been imported, right, from the Britain or from the England, was also, you know, routed out. The complete iron and steel production specifically by the craft people in India. So there was two reasons. The first is the British conquest, which have not been provided the enough patronage to the to such sword industries and armor making industry in India, so which was ultimately died down. And the second is the imported items, which is made up of iron and steel from the England, also displaced right, the craft people who basically work for this iron and steel production. So all such reasons has led to the decline of, you know, the production of the India made armor and sword work. Okay, now what was happened, right, once this armor and, you know, the sword making as well as the craft people, you know, when they stop production of such, you know, iron and steel related work, so what happens is these abandoned furnaces, which was basically used by those craft persons for making the swords and all sorts of implements, now they have abandoned these furnaces in the villages. So obviously, for making the wood steel, what you need a specialized skill, okay? You need a highly specialized manpower or a technique, okay? The ultimate aim is to refine the iron and then to convert those iron into certain set of the armors or other implements like sword, okay? So what happens is in the late 19th century, because of the British policies and because of the British conquest, right, the iron smelting work was basically in the declining side. Right now, many people who were basically behind or who were basically involved in the production of such implements, which is made up of iron and steel, now because of less patronage or because of the loss, they have lost their craft. Right, so many people gave up their craft of making this iron and steel tools. And they started looking for the alternate avenues for making their livelihood, right? So they started making the alternative source of livelihood, and they abandoned these furnaces which was lying in the villages, okay? Now, obviously, because of the British advent, these artisans who were dependent on this iron and steel work, now they faced the new set of competitors, that is, you know, the Britain, or the British people, or basically, you know, the goods which is basically made up of the England, now they have been imported. So the artisans which is producing iron and steel, which is facing these new competitors, right, which is much cheaper and which is being factory made and being imported from the Britain. Okay. Next, how did the iron and steel factories basically again, you know, started growing? Or how did they become more prominent, specifically in the 20th century? So first of all, you must understand the Dorabji Tata. Okay, Dorabji Tata, which is an eldest son of Jamshedji Tata, right, set up a modern iron and steel plant in India. That was in 1904. So the Charles Weld, which is an American geologist, along with the Dorabji Tata, has set up a modern and iron steel plant, right? After that, in 1912, the TISCO, which is known as the Tata Iron and Steel Company, which also came up, okay? This Tata and Iron Steel Company started producing the finest grade of steel. After 2 years of this Tata and Iron Steel, in 1914 to 1918, the First World War basically started. So 1914 was basically a date or a year, right? The World War was basically broke out. So what happens is the British, that was the Britishers basically used to import, right, the British steel, right? Because of this World War, what happens is the channels or the medium of the import basically have fragmented. Now the import of such British steel, which was basically declined, obviously. And the Indian railways, you know, obviously needed the steel for basically, you know, laying down of rails and all such, you know, the steel making items. So what happens is the Indian railways basically turned into the TISCO, which is the Tata Iron and the Steel Company, for the supply of rails, which has led to the increasing demand of the steel from the TISCO, and which has give the further boost to the production of the India made iron and steel, which is in the form of Indian rail. So what happens is, since the World War was continued from 1914 to 1918, by that time, the TISCO has become the biggest steel industry okay, within the British Empire. So the TISCO has supplied a vast amount of steel, right, vast amount of iron, as well as the rails to the Indian railways, which has benefited the Britain as well as the TISCO. And this has led to the TISCO to become the biggest steel industry within the British Empire in the subcontinent. Okay. Now, this was related to the iron and steel. Now you must understand, how did the education basically remains in the British Empire? That we have to see. So first of all, as you have seen that, due to the British policies, almost every section of the society got affected, as you have seen, right? So British rule basically affected the Rajas, Nawabs, peasants, and the tribals. All got affected because of the British policies, okay? And obviously, you must also understand the British also affected the cultural, you know, the policies, okay? The religious policies. So they have certain cultural missions, right? So they have this, you know, the white man's burden to civilize the Indian people, to civilize the natives, okay? To change their customs, to change their values. Obviously, they have the hidden agenda of Christianization of the country, to convert as many as people into the Christianity, as well as obviously the other hidden agenda is to govern the country, okay, without much difficulty. So all such things needed, right, the Britishers to civilize the native, because the more the civilized people are, that will be easier for them to govern according to, you know, the Britishers, because the education which will be provided, right, in terms of such English education would definitely make them puppet in the hands of the Britain. Okay. Now, the British saw education, the tradition of orientation. So that here, so first of all, there was, you know, the two set of that, the education would be provided in the linguistic, right, or in the native language or in the English language. That was basically, you know, the two debate that was there. So William Jones, who was basically a linguist, in 1783 was appointed as a junior judge at the Supreme Court of India, right? So that the company has set up. So he was appointed as a junior judge. Now what happens is, the William Jones, who is basically also linguist, started studying the ancient Indian texts, right? These ancient Indian texts, because since he is basically appointed as a judge, so apart from he was also linguist, so he has the naturally the orientation and inclination towards the studying of such languages, which is written in the, you know, Indian, you know, Indian languages, right? So he started basically reading, studying this Indian text on the law, philosophy, religion, politics, arithmetic, medicine, morality, and other sciences. Okay. Now, there was another Englishman who was known as the Thomas Colebrook and Nathaniel Holland, right? Who was basically also having involvement in the discovering of ancient Indian heritage. Okay. So these two persons also involved in mastering of Indian languages. Okay. These two persons also involved in the translation of the vast amount of Sanskrit work, because there was no such English translation was there on that period of the time. So obviously the most of the materials either lies in the native Indian languages or in the Sanskrit languages. So these, you know, Helhel and Thomas basically involved in the translation of such the Sanskrit work into the English, as well as the Persian works into the English also. Okay, now with the British effort, the Madrasa was basically set up. A Madrasa was set up in 1781 in Calcutta. Ultimate aim is to promote the study of Arabic, Persian, and Islamic law to govern the country more effectively. And in 1791, a Hindu college was also established in Benares. Okay, obviously, to encourage the study of ancient Sanskrit text, okay, that will be useful for the administration of this country. Right, so to study this Arabian, Persian, Islamic, Sanskrit languages, such madrasas and Hindu colleges were basically set up with the effort of British. Okay, now what happens is, this British also, once they set up this one, they started criticizing this Orientalist version of learning, right, or the native language learning, that is in the Persian or in the Urdu or in the Sanskrit or whatever may be the Orientalist version. So they started criticizing, okay, that this orientalist version of the learning is not good. Okay, now James Mill, who was basically also a linguist, attacked on the orientalist, right? So according to him, or according to the James Mill, right, the education or aim of the education ought to be reach what was useful and the practical. So according to him, the English was more scientific language, and English should be reached to the vast section of the population. So language or education should be provided in the English. So his aim was that the education ought to be teach what was useful and what was practical, because he was started attacking all such orientalists. Okay. And according to him, the Indians should be made familiar with all such technical and scientific advances, right? Because obviously on that point of the time, the orientalist, you know, the orientation was basically towards some sort of a, you know, the inner world, not outward. And it was not based on some scientific and technically advanced version, but it was certainly the traditional, you know, the aspect that was involved in the orientalist version of learning. So obviously this was a point that the shift should be from the traditional toward the scientific and the technical, okay, that the British or that the West have made, right? Rather than reading and rather than learning on the poetry, sacred literature, which is in the Orient language. So the Britishers gave basically more emphasis on the scientific and the technical language, technical learning, right? Technical advances, rather than just focusing on the poetry and the sacred literature, specifically in the orientalist tradition. Okay. Then you have Thomas Macaulay. Okay. The Thomas Macaulay was another person, or another English person, who was also critical to the orientalist. Okay. Now, the Thomas Macaulay saw the India as uncivilized country, right? And according to him, the India should be civilized, okay, with the impart of the English language or English education, which is scientific and the rational. So he thinks that India is basically an uncivilized country. Okay. Now, the Macaulay also emphasized the need to teach the English languages in the schools and colleges. Okay, so following that one, a Macaulay Minute, right, which is basically also provided in terms of the English Education Act, which was passed in 1835, was also introduced. Following this, Macaulay's emphasizing on the need of teaching this English language. Okay, and the British also made a decision that the English will be the medium of the instruction for the higher education, right? And obviously, the main aim is to stop the promotion of orientalist institutions, right, specifically at the higher education. So the Macaulay Minute basically provided, right, a roadmap for the English education in India, right? In his, the English Education Act 1835 was passed, and a decision was taken under this that all educational institutions, specifically the higher education institution, would make the English as a medium of instruction rather than making the orientalist institutions or orientalist language, and also stop the promotion of orientalist institutions. Okay, next, in 1854, the Woods Dispatch, right, or Charles Wood, who was the person, the Woods Dispatch is basically an education dispatch which was sent to India to study all such happenings. So what was happens? He outlined the educational policy, okay, that was to be followed in India. So he emphasized on the practical benefit of the system of European learning, okay. So rather than just forcing, right, emphasizing on the practical benefit, right, based on the practicality, right, the benefit of having the European learning. So the Woods Dispatch argued that, right, definitely, it will have some certain sense of, you know, more logical arguments, in the sense that the European learning would definitely improve the moral character of the Indians, right? Obviously, the mind or the temperament of the British is basically that Indian people are uncivilized. They have backward traditions. They have the customs like Sati Pratha. The widow cannot marry, right? The Shudras cannot study in the basically, or Vedas, and all sort of things were there, right? So they think that the Indians have some more immoral character, so they want to improve the moral character of the Indians, right? And also through this European learning, they want to make the Indians more truthful, more honest, right? Obviously, they need this truthful and honest officials, obviously, as a civil servant to serve the company, right? Because such a truthful and honest officers would be trusted, right? And would be dependent by the East India Company that is basically governing the country. So obviously, the wood dispatch also is in the line of, right, you know, providing such truthful and honest officials to the basically, you know, to the East India Company so that these officials can be useful in basically, you know, given such, you know, the officials who, which can be trusted by the company. Okay. Then what happens with these policies? Okay. What happens to the local schools that we have to see? So in 1830, the William Adam, who is basically the missionary or who was belongs to the Scottish missionary, basically came to India and he basically toured the districts of Bengal and the Bihar. Okay. And he was given the charge by the company, right? Now, obviously, the charge by the company given to the, you know, this William Adam was to report on the progress of education in the vernacular schools. Okay. So the vernacular schools which were there, it was mandated that the William Adam should report the progress of education. Okay. Now, what Adam was found, Adam found that the system of education that was there specifically in the districts of Bengal and the Bihar in the vernacular schools, right, that was more flexible, right? And the local school that is functioning in the Bengal and Bihar, that is known as Parshalas, okay? And he also noted that there is no fixed fee in the schools or in the Parshalas. There is no printed books in the Parshalas. There is no separate school buildings. Okay. There is no benches or the chairs. There is no blackboards. There is no system of separate classes. There is no roll call registers. There is no annual examination, no regular timetable. So he found that it is almost a regular process that is basically there, right? Because there is no fixed fee, there is no, no printed books, no schools, no benches, no blackboard, right? No roll calls, no annual examinations. So what is there in these Parshalas? So he found that the teaching process were mainly relied on the oral traditions, okay? The guru will decide what to teach. It is based on the need of the student. Right. So the guru will have the greater role and he decide what to teach and whom to teach. It is based on the need of the student and the such teachings basically based on the oral traditions. So that was the, you know, the pathetic condition he was found specifically in those schools, which was basically, you know, as the vernacular schools, which were basically running in the regional languages. They are called Parshalas. Okay, so the Britishers once collected this information through the Adams, right, who was being appointed to report and such things. Okay, so new routines, new rules were basically, you know, started implementing by the British. So what happens is after 1854, the British East India Company decided to improve the system of vernacular education. Obviously, we have seen all such features that was not good for the development of education, specifically in the vernacular education, in the vernacular, right? So what happens is, through the British East India Company, they started introducing the order within the system that there will be some routines, right? There will be some rules, right? Some regular inspections in the schools, specifically those vernacular schools, okay? And company would appoint a number of government pundits, right? Each in charge of looking after 4 to 5 schools, right? Obviously to check that such rules, regulations, routines, which are regularly followed by such Parshalas, which are basically giving, you know, the education in the vernaculars. Okay, now, obviously the British also introduced certain changes that there were previously no books, okay? There was oral learning of the students. Now, the Britishers started the teaching which was based on the textbooks. Okay, now the learning of the student should be tested. There was no annual examination previously, but now the introduction of the textbooks, there was the feature that all such system of the education or all such learning phase should be tested through an educational or through an annual examinations. Okay, and those parthshalas who accepted the new rules were supported through the government grants. That means those educational institutions which are working as a vernaculars, once they support it, okay, such rules, regulations, such guidelines which were given by the British East India Company, they will be eligible to get the government grants. So they were given certain incentives to change the pattern of education. Okay, so let's understand the agenda for the national education that was implemented. Okay, so obviously with this, certain Indians impressed, right, that the development in the Europe felt that the Western education would have to modernize India. So with that coming into such rules, regulations, and all such advanced learning, right, which has impressed the Indians, that definitely the development in Europe that is happening would definitely benefit, right, India, would definitely help in the modernization of India. Okay, and such Western education would definitely help India also. But the Mahatma Gandhi and Rabindranath Tagore both have reacted against the Western education in India. Okay, now why they have why they have against the English education? They think that the English education has enslaved us. Right, both Rabindranath Tagore and Mahatma Gandhi. So they think that Indian education has enslaved us. Okay, now Mahatma Gandhi, who is also the father of the nation, urges, right, the colonial education to create a sense of inferiority in the minds of India. Right, that such education would create a sense of inferiority. Right, it was a sinful. Right, because it enslaves the Indians. Obviously, it casts an evil spell on them that something is superior, which is basically the English education, which makes a sinful tactic. Right, Mahatma Gandhi wants that education that could help the Indians to recover their sense of dignity and the self-respect. So the Mahatma Gandhi tried to give more emphasis on the vernacular languages, right, so that the Indians could be recovered from their sense of dignity, sense of self-respect. Okay, now Mahatma Gandhi wanted that the Indian language should be the medium of teaching rather than the English should be a medium of teaching. So he emphasized on the Indian languages or the vernaculars should be the medium of teaching, right? And that vernacular should be a medium to develop the person's mind and the soul rather than just depending on the English education. Okay, because according to him, the English education basically enslaves us. Okay, it loses our self-respect, self-dignity, which can be regained if Indians should be taught in their own vernacular languages. Okay, and that too, this language should be taught to the medium of teaching. Now Rabindranath Tagore also have such ideas. He thinks, right, that the Rabindranath Tagore basically started the Shanti Niketan in 1901, that is in the backdrop of the promoting of the English as the language. Okay, so according to him, right, what is there, the creative learning should be encouraged within the natural environment, and such natural environment would be provided by the vernaculars. So what happens is he basically set up a Shanti Niketan. So he set up his school 100 kilometers away from the Calcutta in the rural setting, that is in the natural environment, right? So he basically emphasized on the need to teach the science and technology and the Shanti Niketan along with art, music, and the dance, right? So he started teaching, okay, the need to teach the science and technology along with the art, music, and other aspects. Let's understand the woman caste and reform. Okay, so here as you know that the woman is also not considered equal to the male. Okay, the woman is considered inferior because she has lot of obligations and very less rights, very less privileges, right, in our ancient India time. Okay, now the caste related equations are also not good. As you know that India is basically having the four tier caste system, in which you have at the top level you have Brahmins, then Vaish, then Kshatriya at the second level, then Vaish at the third tier, and the Shudras basically at the fourth tier. Okay, so the women and the caste system need a reform, because the Shudras and the women are considered basically inferior. Okay, so if you consider 200 years ago, what was our society, right? There were so much restrictions on the freedom of women. There were so much restrictions on the caste-related prejudices on the people of the lower caste, or especially the Shudras. Okay, the widows were praised and they are called Satis, means the virtuous, right? The Sati means the woman has to die, or woman has to choose the burning themselves on the funeral pyre of their husband. Okay, so that process or that custom was called Sati. That was called virtuous, and many women died along with the funeral pyre of their husbands. So this custom was also imposed on the woman, and it was considered virtuous. As I told you, that people were basically divided along the lines of caste. So if you see this caste line equations, so if you just divide this fourfold, so at the top level you have Brahmins. Okay, so Brahmins and Kshatriyas considered at the upper caste. Then at the second level, you have Kshatriyas. Okay, at the third level, you have Vaish. At the fourth level, you have Shudras. Okay, both Brahmin and the Kshatriyas, they are considered as a upper caste. Okay, in India. After that, you have the Vaishyas. These Vaishyas are mainly money lenders. Okay, or traders. Their main work is to basically to do the trade and lending the money. The Shudras are basically the fourth one, who are basically the peasants, artisans, weavers, potters, who usually do the occupation which is being not done by basically these money lenders or the traders. So small occupation is being done by the Shudras, and they are also considered untouchables. Okay, there are a lot of the restrictions which were made, right, on the Shudras in that process. Okay, so all such things basically needed a tremendous reform, because without reform, you cannot improve the conditions. So how would the working towards the change was initiated? So first of all, you must understand, in early 19th century, right, things change because of communication, because of the development that was brought by the British East India Company, and also with the effort of some of the native Indians. For example, the social reformer like Raja Ram Mohan Rai, who basically founded the Brahmo Samaj in Calcutta, right, to reform the society, right? The Raja Ram Mohan Rai was basically an intellectual. He wanted that there should be a spread of the knowledge of the Western education, okay? And he also considered that there should be a freedom and the equality for the woman as like a man. So he believes in the equality between man and woman. Okay. And Raja Ram Mohan Rai also, enhanced the conditions of the widows also. All right. So Raja Ram Mohan Rai basically started campaigning against this practice of sati, right, where the woman die along with funeral pyre of their husband. So he started campaigning that such custom is not good for the society. So many British officials also criticized the Indian traditions and the customs, right? This is all looks backward. So the British officials and all such, basically officials have supported the Raja Ram Mohan Rai in this effort. And in 1829, the sati was basically banned in India. So that was the one such great step that was done. Okay. Another most important reformer was Ishwar Chandra Vidyasagar. The Ishwar Chandra Vidyasagar was also, was promoting, the widow remarriage. Okay. Now, with the effort of Ishwar Chandra Vidyasagar, right, the British officials also passed a law permitting the widow remarriage. That means once the husband of a female or of a wife died, right? So she become widow, right? And after that, right, instead of dying through the sati, right, the widow can also remarry. So that is called widow remarriage. So a law was passed in 1856 and British officials basically allow such remarriage done by the widow. Okay. And another such social reformer was Swami Dayanand Saraswati, okay, who founded the Arya Samaj, okay, in 1875. Okay. And also this Arya Samaj, which was founded by Dayanand Saraswati, also supported the widow remarriage. Okay. Now, with all such effort, the girls also started beginning to going to the schools. Okay. Now, many such reformers felt that obviously the improvement in the condition of the women was basically necessary, or education of the girls was basically necessary for the progress of the society, for the progress of family, for the progress of country. Okay. So what happens is many such, you know, schools were set up for girls. So many reformers in the Bombay and basically the Vidya Sagar or Ishwarchand Vidya Sagar basically set up the schools in basically, you know, in the different cities like Calcutta for the girls. Okay. And in aristocratic Muslim families in the northern India, right, the women started learning Quran, which is in Arabic language. Okay. And they were taught by the women who become or who came to home to teach specifically the women or the girls in their homes itself. So the women education also gave lot of emphasizing, right, specifically with the effort of these social reformers, right, which was also the most important aspect of the reforming of our society. Okay. So this has led to further reform in our society. Okay. Now, some of the Muslim women like Begums of Bhopal also started promoting the education among the women. Okay. And such Begum of Bhopal basically also founded the primary schools for the girls at Aligarh. Okay. So the primary school was basically open for specifically for the girls. Okay. And simultaneously, the Begum Rokia Shekhawat Hussain started schools for the Muslim girls in Patna and the Calcutta, obviously to promote the educational avenues to the girls who belong to the Muslim. Okay. And Indian women also started entering the universities by 1880s. Okay. Some of the Indian women also trained to become a doctors or teachers or even engineers also. Okay. The Pandita Rambal was a great scholar of Sanskrit, right, who wrote a book, right, about the miserable life of upper class Hindu women, that despite of having the upper class status, their condition is so pathetic that they don't have rights. They don't have proper human rights, right? So she founded a widow home at Pune to provide a shelter to the widows, right? Obviously, who have treated by their husband relatives very badly, right? For them, a widow home at Pune was basically set up to give the shelter to those women, okay? Jawaharlal Nehru and Subhash Chandra Bose both gave the support, right, to demand for the greater equality and the freedom for the women, specifically in the early 20th century, right, in the 19th century also. So lot of intellectual, lot of social reformers basically all gave, right, their support in favor of giving equal rights to the women and the girls. Okay, let's understand the caste and the social reform. So as you know that the social reformers, we started reforming, right, the caste-related inequalities, the caste-related prejudices, right? So these social reformers was basically started making the Paramahans Mandali, which was founded in 1840 in the Bombay, right? This Paramahans Mandali was basically founded. The main aim is to abolition of the caste system from the India, okay? The Christian missionaries also came out in India and they started setting up the schools for the tribal groups, for the untouchables, for the Shudras, for the lower caste children's, right, to provide the avenues for the equality education to all people. And this has also dismantled the institution of caste in India. obviously the demand for equality and the justice also came from the different sections of the society. Okay, so by the second half of the 19th century, right, so people from the lower caste, right, they also started organizing themselves. They also learned to organize themselves because of the avenues which was provided by the British, right, in terms of education, in terms of the well-defined rules, regulations. So this promoted the lower caste to organize themselves in the movement against such caste discrimination and caste prejudices. And such people started demanding the social equality and the justice. Okay, now the Satnami movement was basically started, okay, specifically in the central India, that was founded by the Ghasidas. The Ghasidas belongs to the low caste, and such Satnami movement also have impacted on the demand for the equality for the untouchables or for the Shudras, right? In Eastern Bengal, the Haridas Thakur, right, led the Matua sect, was also started working among the lower caste Chandalas cultivators. Okay, so the Haridas questioned the authenticity of the Brahmanical text, right, that basically supported this caste system in India. Okay, so this has all led to the great effort from certain sections of the society within the Shudras itself. Okay, next reformer is the Jyotiba Phule, who was born in 1827, and he was also the low caste leader, right? He attacked the Brahmanas, claimed that they were superior to the other, right, since they are belongs to Aryan race. So the Jyotiba Phule also was a social reformer who were actively involved in attacking of the superiority of the Brahmins and their text, since the Brahmins claimed that they were basically Aryans. Okay, so the Jyotiba Phule also believed that the upper caste have no right to their land and to their power, right? Obviously, according to the Jyotiba Phule, the land and the power basically belongs to the indigenous people, right, which are also called the lower caste, since they are the original inhabitants of the land. They are basically cultivating these lands since generations together. Okay, the Jyotiba Phule proposed the Shudras and Ati Shudras should unite to challenge the caste discrimination. Okay, so he basically, provided a much platform where, the Shudras and Ati Shudras should be organized themselves, should be united themselves to challenge this caste-related discrimination. Okay, now the Jyotiba Phule also founded the Satya Shodak Samaj, right? Obviously, the main aim of the Satya Shodak Samaj is to promote the caste equality in the society. And the great reformer, who is also known as Dr. B.R. Ambedkar, and E.V. Ramaswamy Naikar, was also continued this tradition of the caste reform in the 20th century. Okay, that we will learn what was the contribution made by the Ramaswamy Naikar as well as Dr. B.R. Ambedkar in reforming the caste-related prejudices, caste-related inequality in our society, that we have to learn. Now, obviously, you know that the temples were not open to the Shudras. Okay, so the Ambedkar or Dr. B.R. Ambedkar was basically also untouchable. He born in the Mahar family. Okay, and since its beginning or since his childhood, he faced a lot of discrimination, lot of prejudices, right? And he has also experienced lot of such inequalities in the society in the everyday life. So after getting education in 1927, the Ambedkar started agitating for the temple entry movement, because temples, the doors of the temples were basically closed for the people who belongs to untouchable. Right. The main aim of Dr. B.R. Ambedkar is to make everyone eligible, right, to enter into the temples, and there should not be the distribution of the power based on this caste prejudice. So there should be equality in the society. Okay, so a non-Brahmin movement was also started. This non-Brahmin movement was basically started in early 20th century. Okay, obviously the non-Brahmin movement was started by the non-Brahmin caste. Okay, these non-Brahmin caste basically who have organized themselves, who are getting educated, who are getting the wealth and insurance, influence, all such things has led to the organization of and the uniting of such non-Brahmin caste. So they challenge the Brahminical claim, right, that they are the superior. Among them, the E.V. Ramaswamy Naikar, also known as the Periyar, was the middle class family, right? The Periyar founded the self-respect movement, right, obviously for the removal of the untouchability, for the removal of the caste-related prejudices, so removal of the caste-related inequalities, and to reform the society, socially, okay? And his work, or Ramaswamy Periyar's work, inspired the untouchables, right? And the Periyar also asked the people, specifically the lower caste people, to free themselves from all religions in order to achieve the social equality, right? And the Periyar was basically, you know, very critic to the Hindu scriptures. He was basically outspoken, right? He was critical to the Hindu scriptures, right? He has given the forceful speeches, writings, movements, which were basically supported by the lower caste people, lower caste leaders, right, which has led to rethinking their ability, right? Also, some of the caste nationalist leaders also, upper caste nationalist leaders also supported the Periyar aim of the social reforming of the society, right? So that's all for the today, guys. We will meet tomorrow for our next current affairs, sorry, for our next NCERT book. So thank you very much for this session. We'll meet tomorrow. Thank you.